The NSF-funded project uses organic solvents as probes to the binding surfaces of proteins. And the goal of the project is to detect binding patterns that lead to an understanding, a better understanding of the fundamental properties of protein binding sites. I came to this project quite a while back, you know, very slowly developing these ideas. Starting back at graduate school, I went to graduate school at MIT, and back then I was working with a protein called elastase. It's a protease which basically chops down, cleaves proteins into its component amino acid residues, but into parts. Back then we were doing some work on studying how ligands bound to this protein. And we found that if we modified just a little part of the ligand, it often changed the way that the ligand would interact in the binding site. So that led to the question of really what are the guiding rules that determine the way a ligand binds in a protein binding site. And a little bit later in my graduate career, my advisor, who's Greg Petsko at MIT at the time, and he was working in collaboration with Dagmar Ringa, and they had started a collaboration with Alex Klebanoff at MIT, who's looking at the properties of proteins, inorganic solvents, enzyme catalysis, inorganic solvents. And had, in this collaboration, done a crystal structure of another protease called subtilisin in acetonitrile, and found that instead of having the entire protein solvated by this organic solvent, the organic solvent bound primarily in binding sites, what we knew was the binding site of the protein. This is the time that I had been working on this project with inhibitors of elastase, and we thought it would be a great idea, and Greg and Dagmar at the time thought it would be a really good thing to see what happens if we put elastase in these organic solvents. That's where this whole idea began, and that's how we started using organic solvents, not as a solvent in which to do enzyme catalysis, but as probes to study details of binding sites on proteins. One key result is that we have found that indeed the organic solvents bind primarily in the binding sites, what we know are the sites of these proteins. So it's not something unique to elastase. The other important finding that we had is that intracellular proteins are very amenable to this method. And whereas in proteases, we have smaller ligands, kind of small molecule inhibitors that we were studying. In something like the RAS GTPase, which was part of this project, we have more extensive sites of protein-protein interactions. So we've also learned that organic solvents are really good probes to study the interactions with larger proteins as well as with small molecules. So we've really have shown the feasibility of the method to get at fundamental properties of binding sites. Set of results have to do with how plasticity, that is, how adjustments of the protein structure to the different environments relate to the way molecules bind to the protein. And a third component, so we have the organic solvents as the first component that I talked about, the plasticity or adjustment of the protein structure as a second component. And we're also looking at hydration, that is, how do water molecules interact on the surface of the protein to facilitate binding of molecules in the active site. So we're looking at all these three aspects, and we have found that all of them are important, and we need to look at those three things together rather than, well, we do look at them apart, but then we have to integrate that to really understand what the patterns are. Every protein, or virtually all proteins, function by interacting with either small molecules or other proteins. So in order to understand how we can interfere with proteins that are malfunctioning, for example, we need to understand the fundamental properties of binding sites. And I try to, you know, every student coming into biochemistry is interested in making a difference in the world, you know? So the entrance part is not necessarily through, oh, I want to understand everything fundamental about science. The initial motivation tends to see, you know, tends to be, oh, I want to cure disease. For a large number of the students, of course, there are the exceptions that are already hooked, you know, in the fundamental understanding. So I try to make that link to them that, you know, and you're only going to be able to make that difference if you can understand how proteins work. How do ligands interact in binding sites? You know, what are the driving forces? Before we can do anything with, trying to change the way malbehaving proteins are functioning. And interfere with their function and disease. So, and once they understand that, you know, that's kind of the entrance, because once they start working with the project, the curiosity of just understanding the fundamental properties really in the end takes over a lot of this. So this is a great entrance and relevance to their world. And it's a great entrance into the scientific community, and how exciting it can be to just understand how proteins work. I have never learned more effectively than when I was completely involved in a thought process. You know, when I was engaged with discovery. And I think that is a fundamental difference between students passively sitting in a classroom receiving information and actually doing hands-on interaction with the research, you know, because that, even if it's a little bit compared to all the classes that they have to take, that dipping into their own intellectual curiosity about discovering how something works gives a much greater motivation and understanding for why they're sitting in a classroom learning all this material. It just gives sense to the material that they're learning in the classroom. So, and it gives a sense of purpose. And it's much less boring than having somebody up there lecturing. And of course, in my classes, we have to do some of that because there's a certain amount of material that we have to cover. But for this project, what I've tried to do is to link what we do in the classroom with the structural biology that they're doing in this research project. So that's kind of at the undergraduate level. The way I designed this project was to not only pay attention only to how undergraduates are learning, but also to bring graduate students this sense of how mentoring is important to get the project done, and also for their own learning. You know, how much more you learn if you're talking to students and trying to explain the project and telling them how, in our case, the structural refinement is done. And I find that the graduate students get engaged at a level that is really doesn't happen if they're sitting isolated in a room with their crystal structure trying to figure out how to solve it. So it brings in, you know, a teamwork that goes not only from the typical situation, which is the graduate student has to TA a lab, okay, that lab has nothing to do with their thesis or research or anything else, but they have to do it. And they have to, because that's the way the graduate student program. And it's taken away from their time in the lab. Yes, they do it, but they don't do it with their heart as much as if this undergraduate is working on the structure that's going to be part of my thesis, you know, and then there's an engagement, there's a teamwork that you just don't see in kind of a classroom laboratory that is not involved with the research. So basically, I think what we've managed to do is to integrate research at all levels of the academic ladder, because we also have a postdoc involved in this project, and I am very intimately involved with working with the students as well. It benefits the students, and it benefits the graduate students and postdocs and the science, because the result of what the undergraduates are doing feeds into to the project in the lab. So they're in effect a team. We are a team with a common goal. We just happen to be at different stages of our, you know, educational scientific lifetime. I am very, very fortunate to have grown up in a family of scientists. Okay, my mother is not only of scientists, but women scientists as well. So both my parents are physicists, mother and father. My grandmother is a physicist. Well, she's retired, but she was a physicist, and so was my grandfather. My other grandfather was a very prominent biologist in Brazil. I don't know if you know this, but I'm originally from Brazil. I moved to this country in 1981. And became an American citizen in the year 2000. So it's, you know, fairly recent. My whole family is still in Brazil. But I grew up in this very rich scientific environment. There were conversations at the dinner table and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, when I took a lot of things for granted that I realized was not there for our young students coming into science, you know, things like, you know, role models, accessibility to discussions, and, you know, importance of science. I just grew up with all of that. And of course, then, you know, to even complicate matters more, there are the all the pressures in our society for young women, you know, and balance with family and all of that, which is, you know, it's important, and it does have an effect on who ends up doing science in our society. So I've, over the years, I've become very, very much aware of that. Another interesting time in my life, I had a postdoctoral fellowship at the Bunting Institute at Radcliffe College. I spent 2 years there doing my postdoc years. And during that time, I was working with Martin Karplis at Harvard on molecular dynamic simulations of protein, which kind of has a, you know, we're looking at energetics of protein rather than structure, the coupling of structural and energetics. But anyway, during that time, I talked to a lot of young women who were in a similar situation as I was, in a similar period in my career. In our careers, and found that, you know, we were all at the age of, you know, getting married, having children, and really coming to make those decisions about, can I continue in science? Can I have a family and do science at the same time? And at that point, I already had, you know, an 8-year-old, and it's, you know, so that's another part for me that I took for granted, because that my grandmother and my mother actually went ahead and had families and did science all at the same time. I knew that could be done.
Well, I started as a freshman, and I was learning how to do the crystallization of the proteins, and that was before I'd taken any courses in biochemistry or anything. So It was a good introduction to the lab, though. And then I started learning how to do the structure refinement on another protein, chymotrypsin. And then in the spring of my sophomore year, I went to England and started and worked with Carla at the EBI, learning a bit about the bioinformatics end of the project and starting to help with learning the searching or looking at elastase, the binding sites in that. I'm pretty interested in structural biochemistry now, and I probably wouldn't have known that area in as much detail if I had just taken classes and not been involved in Carla's lab. So it's definitely directed me towards that area of biochemistry.